Good afternoon, church. Have you been blessed already being in God's house? If you have, let me hear you say amen. And if you are anticipating greater blessings as our service moves along, let me hear you say hallelujah. Because if you're not anticipating more, then you won't receive more. But if you're in a mode of expectation, that means the lid of the jar is open and God can pour in. But if you're not expecting anything, the jar lid is closed and there's nothing that can come in. I thank Pastor Spencer for allowing me this opportunity to work overtime, triple time. You know, you can always tell a West Indian, they say, by the fact that West Indians don't just have one job. Two or three jobs. So during the week, I'm doing the medicine thing, and on the weekends, I'm doing the preaching thing, and my God. And God is able to infuse strength where we're weak. Amen. I invite you to stand and take your Bibles, and I want to acknowledge the presence of my dear friend, Pastor Richard Bryant, who came today to worship with us. This revival weekend under the umbrella God reigns. John, the first chapter, and we're going to read verses 1 to 5. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. And the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life. And the life was the light of men. And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. I want you to look at your neighbor and say, step back, stand back, he's got you. Step back, stand back, because he's got you. Bless your word to your people today. We look to you. Disappoint us not. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated. Mr. Soundman. Give me a little more.
From the mighty to the small, the glory in them all is God's and God's alone. God and God alone reveals the truth of things we call unknown.
and all the best and worst of man won't change the master's plan, 'cause it's God and God alone. God and God alone is able to make the universe his throne. Let everything that lives reserve its truest praise for God and God alone. God and God alone will be the joy of our eternal home. He's gonna be my one desire. My heart will never tire of my God and God alone. God and God alone is able to make the universe his throne. Or let everything that lives reserve it to his praise. For God and God alone, God and God alone is able to make the universe his throne. Oh, let everything that lives reserve its truest praise for the God and God. Let everything that lives reserve its truest praise. Put your hands together if you believe that. Can I take my time? Step back. Stand back. He's got you. He's got you. And who better to have you? Oh, I'm ready. I'm ready. I'm ready. And who better to have you than God? The Word of God is made up of 66 books. And it's oftentimes felt that the Word of God is challenging and difficult to understand. But that's counterintuitive. Because why would God present something, declare something that is difficult to understand? Why would God give me his word and then I become dependent upon a preacher to understand? Oh no. Why would God give me his word and then make it necessary for me to go to seminary in order to understand the word? Why would God do that? It's counterintuitive. The word is simple, and it doesn't require an advanced degree to understand it. I've learned more about God's word and God outside of seminary than in seminary. Life has taught me more about God. Oh, my. So the books are divided into Old Testament and New Testament. It's a simple thing. Old Testament problem, New Testament solution. Old Testament sin, New Testament salvation. Old Testament the wages of sin, New Testament eternal life. It's done. Everything else is filler. You're listening. Everything else is detail. Old Testament points to, New Testament points out. It's not complex. In fact, the only reason why you need a preacher is to speak the word, not to explain the word, but to speak the word, because the power is in the spoken word. We need preaching because preaching initiates faith. Because faith cometh by, and hearing by the word of God. So what we do as preachers is simply to present the word and let the word create the faith. So we get to the New Testament. And there are, let me read this so I don't get it wrong. I'm going somewhere. Stay with me. There are 31,102 verses in the Bible. There are 23,145 verses in the Old Testament, 7,957 verses in the New Testament. The New Testament begins with the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. I don't know if you understand what God is doing. There is a significant distinction from the very outset or onset, depending on how you want to look at it. There is a significant difference in the gospel presentations of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and that of John. Matthew, Mark, and Luke begin their introduction of Jesus with genealogy and historicity, and where he was born and what preceded his birth, and the manger and Mary and so forth, and let you know that he lived in a certain place at a certain time and all the events that surrounded his birth. That's Matthew, Mark, and Luke. John presents completely differently. Matthew, Mark, and Luke lets you know that man, the Son of Man, became the Son of God. Matthew, Mark, and Luke take time to show you that this man that was born of the Virgin Mary was not an ordinary man, but was God. John starts out different. John starts out with him be God. John doesn't tell you how. John says he's God. John starts out with a conclusion that he's God. And then everything else follows a conclusion that he makes from the very beginning. So John starts out with in the beginning God. He doesn't say that he was begat. Oh, you now hear me. John doesn't start out and deal with begat. He doesn't start out with Herod. He doesn't talk about the three wise men. He says, in the beginning, God. He's letting you know. As you start this journey in my gospel, I am dealing and presenting God to you. And the reason why John does this is because of his relationship with Jesus. Are you not hearing me? He had walked with him, spent so much time with him, that he came to the conclusion after his death that this had to have been God. So he starts with God, who is man. Whereas Matthew, Mark, and Luke start with man, who is God. This is critical because where you start determines where you end. And so central to God, John's presentation, and perhaps central to all of Scripture, is perhaps one of the most familiar verses in the entire Bible. Central. Because he's telling you God. And then he says, for God. Oh my goodness. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Simple. Not a whole lot of theology. Not a whole lot of studying. God so loved. Now, what's critical from the outset is that John points out in that verse that the initiator of the process of reconciling man to God is not man, but God. You see, this is why God is God, and this is why Jesus is Jesus, and I ain't there yet. Here's the situation. Man is the one who broke the relationship. Man is the one who messed up. Now let me tell you about me. You see, if you do me something wrong, I'm waiting for you to apologize for the wrong that you've done me. I'm going to wait. And if it's 1 year, 5 years, I'm waiting for you to tell me you're sorry. But that's why God is God. Because he's not waiting for me to apologize to him. He comes to me. God is not waiting for man to come to him. God comes to man. It is God that pulls me to himself. I can't come to God. I can't come to God, my brother. God has to pull me to himself. I don't even have the desire. I don't even have the desire to seek after God. In fact, I don't even think I did anything wrong that needed. And that's the problem. We're not even aware of our condition. And even if we were aware of our condition, we don't have the capacity to do anything about it. Are you listening to me? I can know that I'm in need, but don't have the power or the energy to extricate myself from the situation that I'm locked in, because it's in my nature. It's in my DNA, man. I know what I ought to do. I know what I should do, but I don't even have the power to do it. So Paul says, when I would do good, evil is present. Therefore, I find a law in me. So every January, I make a resolution to be better. Every January, I'm not going to eat this. I'm going to do this. And right about now, October. Shucks, tell the truth. Shame the devil. Don't even wait till October. Resolutions are gone. Because you don't have the... It is impossible for the creature. It is impossible for the creature to reconcile himself or herself to the creator. You just don't have that kind of power. Therefore, the creator has to come to the creature. Now, implied in that is some significant facts. Because since he is the initiator of the reconciliatory process, since he's the one who is bringing me to himself, he, God, has to take responsibility for the outcome. Are you listening to me? God has to take responsibility for the outcome, since he's the one who started it. And whoever started it has to be responsible for the outcome. And God is responsible for the outcome. And let me tell you something about God. God never starts anything and doesn't finish it. Hold on. Oh, Jesus. God never starts anything and not finish it. So what he has started in me, he will perform until the day of Jesus Christ. What he started, he will finish. And it doesn't matter how it looks to you. Oh no. It doesn't matter how it looks to you. How it may seem to you that the product is not yet done. It's not up to you. It's up to God, because he's the one who started it. Stop opening the oven. Let the cake bake. Stop criticizing me. Stop putting your mouth on me. Stop trying to discourage me. Let the cake bake, because God has started it and God will finish it. And every time you open that oven door, every time you open that oven door and you peel back my sins and talk about my failures and talk about my weaknesses, you're delaying the process. Are you listening? When you delay the process, you cause me to become discouraged. And you cause me to make me feel like I want to turn back and give up and not come to church anymore. Take your mouth off me. So what if I wear a little jewelry? Take your mouth off me. God is baking. Hold on. God is baking. It's God who has initiated the process. And God doesn't start anything he doesn't finish. And God can't fail. Are you listening to me? He can't fail because he's God. I don't know who I'm preaching to, but God is in your life. And once God comes in your life, it doesn't matter what's going on in your life. You can't fail. The victory is guaranteed. So don't wait for the battle to be over. Shout now. victory is mine now. Because it's God, you see. It says God so loved. And the motivating factor for God's actions towards me is just that. His love for me. A love that I don't deserve and can never earn. Why he loves me, I don't know. But I'm glad he did. Why he loves me despite my failures and my weaknesses, I don't know. But I'm glad he did. Why he loves me despite my broken promises, I don't know. But I'm glad he does. And you know the funny thing about this whole conceptualization? The funny thing about it is that God can love me despite of whether I love him or not. Oh my God, you now hear me. No. You see, God's love for me is independent of my love for him. Are you listening? His love for me is independent of how I feel towards him. Because he loved me before I loved him. Oh my God. He loved me when I was in the pit of sin. He loved me when I was roaming in the beds of hell. He loved me when I was messing up. He loved me. He loves me regardless of my action. Hold on. He loves me not because of my actions, but despite my actions, because he just loves me. Not what I do or don't do. He just loves me. He just loves me. And I'm glad he's the one who loves me. You see, hold on. When you love me. Oh. You see, because you can love me today and not love me tomorrow. No. You can love me today and not love me tomorrow. But because God dwells outside of time, and you dwell in time, your love is variable. Your love is dependent upon how you feel and your mood and where you are at the moment. And whether or not I'm doing what pleases you or not. But God, since he dwells outside of time, his love is independent of time and independent of the actions that occur in time. Are you listening to me? You love me if I listen to you. You love me if I do what you say. God loves me regardless. So that while we were yet, oh my God, while we were yet sinners, Christ died. Love that will not let, oh Jesus. The love of God is greater far than tongue or pen can ever tell. It goes beyond the highest star and reaches down there where midday in the deepest hell. I wish I had some real people up in here, because everybody up in here act like they've never been down in hell. You've been down in hell. That's where Jesus found you. You weren't born saved. Stop it. Come up in here acting like you were born saved. No, the Bible says we were all born as sinners. So God, the initiator, so loved the world. It's going to get good. So God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son to the world. Hold on. He so loved the cosmos. He so loved the world and all the inhabitants of the world that he gave his only begotten son to the world. But notice that even though the gift is to the world, the reception of the gift is individualized. Oh my goodness, my goodness, my goodness. So that whosoever, so you have the world gift and the reception of the gift is individualized, so that whoever believeth. So you got to understand, preacher, you got to understand that this salvation business is not a church business. It's not a everybody business. Oh my God, it's an individual business. The gift is for all, but the reception is for one. And the reason why it has to be individualized and personalized is because God wants individual and personalized praise. You're not hearing me. He doesn't want corporate praise. He wants individual praise. Your praise to God is unique and idiosyncratic to you. Your praise to God is like your thumbprint. Ain't nobody else in this whole congregation that can praise God like you, because nobody else has been through what you have been through. Somebody to just say, praise the Lord for loving me. Sit back. Stand back. He's got you. Now, can I take it a little further? Can I go a little deeper before I go a little higher? Can I go down a little bit? Now watch it. He says, so that whosoever believeth in him. Does not say whosoever has faith. It doesn't say whosoever has faith in him, but just whosoever believeth in him. There is a critical distinction that must be made between faith and belief. You see, faith is relational. You have faith in who and what you know. You have faith in God because of your previous relationship with God and what God has done for you in the past. So you have faith that the same God of yesterday will be the God today. But in our scripture, he doesn't want you to start there. He's not expecting you to start there, because you're starting. And if you're starting, you can't have faith, because faith comes after you started. Faith comes after you've been through some stuff. So he says, all I want you to do is to believe that this is the Son of God. Just believe. Belief is the fundamental element. It's the foundation. It's the substratum of faith. I believe and then I have faith. Everybody who has faith believes, but not everybody who believes has faith. So God only wants you to start with belief. Just to acknowledge that he is God. just to acknowledge that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And watch, it's not the faith that saves, it's the belief. He says, if you believe, you'll have eternal life. Whosoever believeth shall not perish. But just believe that this is God, that Jesus is God, and that he died for your sins. Faith is preservational. Stay with me. Faith is preservational. Belief is invitational. Faith is preservational. Belief is invitational. It's the faith that keeps me in the midst of the storm. It's the faith that preserves me when I'm going through. It's the belief that lets me come to the God who can deliver. Okay. Belief brings me. Faith keeps me. Oh, Jesus. Oh, my God. I don't know who I'm preaching to. And he doesn't say, believe in the doctrine. All 28. And you know some words coming there. I was coming. You knew I was coming. I was coming. He doesn't say, believe in the church. He doesn't say, believe in the doctrines. He doesn't say, believe in the Sabbath. Are you listening? I know that's heresy to some of you. But he doesn't say, believe in the Sabbath. He doesn't say, believe in eating this and not. He says, believe in Jesus. Because the church can't save. The day can't save. The food can't save. Only Jesus. Somebody ought to hear me. Only Jesus can save. And that's why some of you holding on to these things that can't save you are so miserable. Hold on. Some of you are so mean because you're holding on to stuff that's empty. You have no joy. But if you hold on to Jesus, he'll give you joy. He'll make you happy. Whom the Son hath set free is. Sit back. Stand back. He's got you. Not of works, lest any man. It is the gift of God. It has to be that way because we all have different strengths and weaknesses. One person, so one person may have a particular weakness for chocolate. I ain't looking at you. Another person may have a weakness for you know, ice cream. And so what is tempting to you is not tempting to me. And my weakness is not your weakness, and your weakness is not my weakness, neither is your strength my strength. That's why it's not of works, lest any man should boast. Because just because you're not being tempted by your weakness doesn't make you better. Oh, no. Just because you're not being tempted by your weakness, and I am, and I happen to fall for my weakness. Hold on. When your temptation to your weakness comes, watch what happens to you. Up in here, I wish I had some real church people who knew that weaknesses come to everybody.
Bible says, let no man think that you're tempted against what you don't like. You're only tempted with what you like. Satan ain't got a lot of time, so he ain't gonna waste his time tempting you on something that you know he knows you don't have a weakness for. Are you listening to me? Why is Satan gonna waste his time to tempt me for something I don't have a weakness for? He ain't got much time. His time is short. He's getting ready to burn up. I'm just saying. No, that's not bad. That's bad theology. I'm sorry. But Satan is not going to waste time on my strengths. He's not going to come at me that way. He's going to come at me at my weakness. That's why it's not of works, so that nobody can boast. It is the gift of God. To everyone that that believeth.
I'm getting ready to close. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that who, oh, let me hear you, that who, I want you to forget the who and put your name. Let me hear some different names in the house, so that Lee Croft, Mary, Susie, John, Richard, believeth, shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Who are you believing in? He's the King of Israel. He's the King of righteousness. He's the King of the ages. He's the King of glory. He's the King of kings and Lord of lords. There is no means or measure that can define his limitless love. He's enduringly strong, entirely sincere, and he's eternally steadfast. He's immortally graceful, imperially powerful, and impartially merciful. He's the greatest phenomenon that has ever crossed the horizon. He's God's son. He is God. He's the sinner's savior. He's the centerpiece of civilization. He's unparalleled. He's unprecedented. He's the highest idea in literature. He's the highest personality in philosophy. He's the fundamental doctrine of all theology. He's the only one qualified to save. He's all sufficient. He supplies strength for the weak. He's available for the tempted and tried. He sympathizes and he saves. He sustains and he strengthens. He guards and he guides. He heals the sick and he cleanses the lepers. He forgives sinners and discharges debtors. He frees the captives. He defends the feeble. He blesses the young. Oh, I can keep going. He serves the unfortunate. He regards the aged. He rewards the diligent. He beautifies the meek. He's the key of knowledge. He's the wellspring of wisdom. He's the doorway of salvation. He's the pathway of peace. He's the roadway of righteousness. He's the highway of holiness. He's the gateway of glory. His goodness is limitless. His life is matchless. His mercy is everlasting. His love never changes. His word is enough. His grace is sufficient. He reigns in righteousness. His yoke is easy. His burden is right. He is indescribable. He is incomprehensible. He is invincible. He is irresistible. You can't get him off your mind. You can't wash him off your hand. You can't live without him, and you can't be here without him. Pilate couldn't find fault with him. Herod couldn't kill him. Death couldn't hold him. And the grave couldn't keep him. Lift up your head, all ye gates, and be ye lifted up, ye everlasting door, for the King of glory shall come in. Who is the King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty. The Lord mighty in battle. He is the King of glory.
Oh, when we all get to heaven. My God, my God, my God. When we all get to heaven. What a day. What a day. What a day of rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout. So watch this. Watch this. Watch this. So John gets a peek into heaven, see? He gets a peek and he sees the 24 elders bowing down and praising God. And John said, oh, that's good. And he looks over a little further and he sees 144,000 singing and praising God. And John says, oh, that's good. But then he listened a little bit and he heard a loud and thunderous voice. There was a multitude that no man could number. I may not be in the 24. I may not be in the 144,000. But I thank God I am in the. Oh, when the saints go marching in. Oh, when the saints go marching in. Oh, Lord, I want to be in that number. When the saints go marching in. And when they crown him Lord of Lords. And when they crown him Lord of Lords. Oh, Lord, I want to be. When they crown him Lord of Lords. And when they gather round God's throne. And when they gather round God's throne. Oh Lord, I want to be in that number. When they gather round God's throne. Swing Lord, sweet chariot, coming for to carry me home. Sweet Lord, oh my Lord, sweet chariot, coming for to carry me home. I'm gonna sing, 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 I'm gonna shout, 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 I'm gonna sing, I'm gonna shout, praise the Lord. Oh, when the gates are open, I'm gonna sit on Jesus' side. I'm gonna sing, I'm gonna shout, praise the Lord. Oh, come let us adore. Oh, I wish I had some worshipers today.
Oh, come let us adore him.
Oh, come let us adore. Put your hands together, give God a praise in this house. Oh no, let him hear you. Let him hear you. The angels wish they could, but all they can do is give praise of adoration. You can give praise of thanksgiving. Give God a praise of thanksgiving for what he has done for you, for how he brought you through, to how he kept you. For God so loved the world. That he gave his only begotten Son, so that whosoever believeth, just simple belief, don't have to know a lot, don't have to understand a lot. Don't have to comprehend a lot. You may have intellectual deficiencies. It doesn't matter. Just believe. And the moment, my God, and the moment instantaneously when you express that belief, There was a dying thief on the cross. Him never have time for go church. Him never have time for be a tide. Him never. He just believed. And Jesus said, this day. I'm going to open the doors now. And if you're here today and you heard God speaking to you, forget the folks around you. Forget your doubts. It's God who's starting this, you know. And if God's forget the obstacles. He can make the mountains into valleys. He can smooth out the rough places. He can turn the crooked ways and make them straight. You want to just say, Lord, I believe. I'm going to ask you to slip out of your seat and come down front. Whether you're a visitor, member, just slip and come. And say, Lord, I believe. I believe that Jesus is the Son of God. I believe that he died on the cross to save me. I believe that his blood is able to overcome all my weaknesses and all my sins. I believe that he's able to change me and transform me. I didn't mention this, but it's true. You see, belief is transformational. When you believe that he is God, it's transformational. Faith preserves, belief transforms. Does anybody need to be transformed today? Been doing your thing for a long time without success, and you need to be transformed today. How long are you going to keep living the same life, doing the same thing, and expect, as they say, a different result and call yourself intelligent? Come unto me, all ye that labor.
Wow, wasn't that a powerful service? If even one thing from today has had a positive impact on you, then it makes all of this worthwhile. So, if you are inspired to reach out to us, you can contact us here on our website or on our Facebook page. And if you want to see more videos, check out our archives down below. So see you next week. Same time, same place. Bye.
For the Lord is holy,
holy,
mighty,
mighty,
righteous.